Tuesday, like that's from 9 to 10, so midnight. I'm not going to drive. Good morning. I see it's very dark in here to keep all the heat out. It's a good idea. Thank you for joining us this morning for an Emerging Artist Series concert. I have an announcement to make. You see the first piece on your program, the Tomasi. It will not be performed today. One of the members is dealing with an injury, so I think it's better to not make that person play. Just as a kind of a note about this, I consider all our fellows and all the musicians here to be, in a sense, athletes. They're here, they're playing between 5 and 8 and 10 hours a day, and so it's natural that with any athletic event, there are times when people are fatigued, you know, in terms of playing, or they get a slight injury, and I always tell them it's best to think long term to make sure that they can play for many years rather than trying to grit their teeth and play this one concert. So, you know, this happens from time to time, but we still will hear the Arensky Quartet, and I think you'll find that interesting for a particular reason. I think when you hear a string quartet, you could think that the regular string quartet is top heavy, right? You have two violins, which is the highest instrument, and that has a particular sound. And with the Arensky Quartet, that has two of the lowest instrument. You see that quartet has two cellos instead of two violins, and that gives that ensemble a unique sound, which you'll hear in the Arensky. I hope you can join us tonight when we have members of the St. Lawrence Quartet joined by pianist Natalie Zhu and our fellows in a program of Mozart E-flat Piano Quartet and the Dvorak Sextet. Thank you for being here and enjoy the concert.
Hi, everybody. Thank you for joining us this morning. Today we'll be performing Arensky's second string quartet. Arensky is maybe a composer you've never heard of before, and even among us musicians, we haven't played much of his music, don't know much about him. He was a composer of the late 19th, early 20th century, and was kind of a child prodigy. By the age of 9, he was composing piano pieces and writing songs. And he ended up studying composition with Rimsky-Korsakov, and then eventually went on to Moscow, where he met Tchaikovsky, and Tchaikovsky became not only a friend, but a mentor. And this piece is actually dedicated to the memory of Tchaikovsky. It was written a year after Tchaikovsky died. And Chris will talk about this a little bit, but each movement, there are themes taken from many things, and the second movement is actually strictly taken from one of Tchaikovsky's melodies. I think it's Opus 51, a piano piece. But yeah, Chris, would you like to? Yeah.
Thank you, Evan. It's such a treat to be up here to play this piece with these wonderful people at 10:30 in the morning. Why not? This piece is fascinating because of its source material, really, among other things. I mean, Arensky was quite the craftsman, so the way in which he incorporates these thematic ideas into the piece and then sometimes even masks them a bit, hides them underneath other ideas. But I thought it might be nice to sort of lay out perhaps the main four ideas that you will hear and give you a couple of examples of how maybe he hides them into the texture from time to time. Right at the start of the piece, we hear this Russian Orthodox chant. And let's just lay that down for you right now. So you'll hear this many times in the course of the first movement. It may even make an appearance somewhere else in the piece, but we won't tell you where. This is the opening Russian Orthodox chant.
Thank you.
So I think you'll clearly notice that at various other times in the piece. It's pretty straightforward. We don't know the text. The only source material we found has it in Cyrillic, and we're not particularly good at reading that. But nonetheless, you can, I think, imagine immediately that this is something that could be chanted in a religious setting. Now, I want to give one example of the way in which he disguises this or hides this theme a little bit, changes it a little bit. Let's play just at number three, if you will. So you'll hear this theme somewhere, one of us is going to be playing it, and other things will be going on simultaneously. Could you hear it? Who had it? Moi, yes. in an augmented version, meaning it was moving more slowly. But harmonically, I mean, it's harmonized, first of all. The opening is not at the start. Furthermore, there's new material sort of stacked on top of it. So it's a little bit disguised, but one will hear it, I think, nonetheless. Now, if we leave this movement behind for the moment, go to the second movement, the movement based on the theme of Tchaikovsky, let's just quickly play the opening theme, which is the theme written by Tchaikovsky that Evan referred to earlier. I suspect most of you will have heard that theme before. It is one that we tend to be familiar with. I wanted to point out one example. Now, of course, you'll hear that theme throughout the variations. It's a theme in variations. And the seventh variation is, as Evan is saying, yeah, this is a beautiful way to showcase this. Let's play a little of the seventh variation and just listen to where he goes with it. Just to give you an example, just a few bars. And there was one other example as well we'll show you. So hear how far he's gone with that theme in minor key to major key and really, really, really morphed it into something completely different. One more example, variation five, this is, listen to how he places the theme. I'll give you the clue. The clue is kind of what happened in that example in the first movement where I was playing the theme. Did in the first movement. I have the theme here, but it's much slower, and there's all this beautiful material sort of stacked on top of it, and harmonically speaking, it goes into a completely different place. So it's a very well-crafted, interestingly crafted set of variations with that Tchaikovsky theme. And then we get to the last movement, which is kind of almost like a coda. It's not really a big movement of sorts. It does, though, showcase two particular themes that I think we should show you. There is a kind of hymn-type theme at the very beginning of the movement. And finally, when things really get rolling in this movement, we hear a theme that those of you who know the Razumovsky quartets of Beethoven, in particular Razumovsky number 3, opus 59 number 3, will recognize this Russian, number 2, sorry, I always do this, number 2, number 3 is the one that doesn't have a Russian theme. The Russian theme, and it, thank you, it's a good thing to have colleagues on stage with you, they can tell you when you're wrong. Opus 59 number 2, scherzo movement. If you know this movement, you'll recognize this tune. And in terms of form, he's essentially creating a fugato, a kind of fugue section, double fugue section. You have this Russian theme, you have what Mac was just playing on the cello part, and he tosses those ideas around amongst the four of us. So that is pretty much lays out the thematic material. Listen for where these ideas come back, recur in different ways, in transformed ways, as we were just showing you. And it's a good chance you haven't heard this piece before, I suspect. I know some of you have, but many of you haven't. And as Melvin pointed out, unusual scoring for violin, two cellos, and viola. The viola part sometimes lives in this violin world, as Haneul will be happy to tell you afterward. A lot of activity in the viola part in particular, but the first cello part is often much like a viola part. And so he uses this texture in the best of possible ways. Interestingly, that is interesting that his publisher thought this wouldn't sell and wanted him to turn it into a regular old string quartet, which he did. But this is the version that we really, really want to be listening to, I think. I also want to just commend my colleagues here on stage who have never played this piece before. They delved into it well, like, you know, jumping off a platform into some deep water, starting only Wednesday when we had to toss things and change things around a little bit and switch repertoire. And I said to them, hey, what do you guys think about doing this Arensky two cello quartet? I said, yes, let's do it. So it's amazing what, absolutely incredible what they were able to do. And collectively, I feel we were able to do in this short amount of time, a piece that often takes a lot longer to get to know. So thanks for being here with us. And we look forward to playing it for you now.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.